So here the main purpose of having this is basically educational. If you want to complete reading the Bible, usually when you come to the book of Exodus, it's the measurements that actually confuses people. And even if you see a picture, it may not give a live experience. That's why this has been constructed. The second thing is about tabernacle. Of course, you may be doing your own study. We cannot limit the study only to tabernacle, because after that Solomon has built the temple. Then we have the second temple called the Zerubbabel's temple. The same temple was called Herodian temple during the time of Jesus Christ. In between the tabernacle and Solomon's temple, David pitched a separate tent only for the Ark of the Covenant. So the tabernacle history from the time the Ark was taken by the Philistines, Ark of the Covenant never went into the tabernacle. So those two different things are there. But coming to the Herodian temple, we need to understand something as we read the New Testament. The Bible says more than the word temple, the Bible says temple courts. Why does the Bible say temple courts? Because this is actually maybe maximum 1 acre or a little less than an acre built by King Solomon, grand structure. But King Herod modified the whole thing. If you want to understand his modification, way ahead was the beautiful gate where Peter and John healed the blind, healed the lame man. He came into the temple praising God. The temple is here, but King Herod gave the picture that from the beautiful gate onwards, it was a temple. So it was a more than 2.5 acres of land, which is now the Temple Mount in Israel. So the lady who put in the 2 coins is also not inside. As you cross the beautiful gate and come inside, there is a place called the Court of Women or the Court of Prayer, where the Pharisee and the publican went to pray. So that is where the offering box was. Jesus cleansing the temple is also not inside. It is here. Because around this, what? So there are, this is basically the Court of Women. Then there is a gate called Nicanor. As you come inside, or the Corinthian gate, you come inside, you come a little further, this is the Court of the Gentiles. In this area is what is called the Solomon's Colonnade, where the disciples were also praying here. So this is where Jesus Christ cleansed the temple. So we go inside, then we go to the outer court and all of that, just as much as it very similar to the tabernacle and all of that. So we will go inside. One thing about very thing that may cause confusion is the east facing part of it. This is in the east facing. It's facing the east. So you know there's something called Vastu or Feng Shui, I think, in the Chinese. So they have these interpretations as to even now an east-facing plot will be more costlier than other facing plots, and people are of the opinion that the door should be to the east-facing, because this was to the east-facing. This is only for the temple construction, nothing to do with domestic constructions, and I will just tell why as we go inside here. Please come. So in the tabernacle, we don't have the Court of Women, the Court of Prayer, which is also the Court of Prayer, and outside is the Court of Gentiles. But here, from here, this is the outer court. And during the time of the Solomon's Temple or the Herodian Temple, as they went closer to the tabernacle proper, they called it the Court of the Priests. But that word Court of the Priest is not there in tabernacle. So the priests were allowed only till here, and the sacrifices were brought in till here. Now, this structure is 60 pillars made with linen curtains. And only in the entrance you have these 4 curtains made with blue, purple, scarlet and white, and it is facing to the east. Now here is something what we can say why it was facing to the east. In the book of Ezekiel, Ezekiel is seeing a prophetic temple. In the prophetic temple, or prior to that, we should know this, in every civilization there is this worship of sun. Not only the sun, it's the rising sun, not the setting sun. So it's very, this is a common trend in the Canaanite religions, and also in many of the religions here in India, the temple will be facing the east. That's because of the temple worship, the sun worship. So if sun worship is important, why is the Israeli, the Jewish place of structure, why is its opening to the east? The idea is, see, when you're reading the tabernacle, we are going from outside and we finally go into the Ark of the Covenant. Those who read only the first few chapters of this tabernacle, most of them, they come inside, because the first there in the description is the Ark of the Covenant, not the altar of sacrifice. So when they come inside, they're confused. They think this is the altar of, this is the Ark of the Covenant. So we are going from outside to inside, Whereas when you are reading in the Bible, the description is from inside to outside. So the point is this. Ezekiel says in chapter 8 verse 16, 25 people, they go inside. And then as they go inside, their back should be this side. But what they purposefully did, they went there, they turned their back to the, it's called the tabernacle proper technically. So they turned their back to the proper and they are worshipping the sun. So the very idea of east facing and the whole structure, not just east facing, the whole structure is once the people come inside, the back is to the sun, but their focus is towards the center. So this is the main difference between the Canaanite religions, the Canaanite places of worship, and also the Jewish place of worship. By the way, the lampstand, there were mud lamps in the Canaanite temples. Mm-hmm. The altars, well, even you will see the Tulasi plant which is grown. Hindus will put it in one thing. It will have four horns. I don't know how many of you have noted that. If you go to the Israeli museum, there are a number of such altars there by the Canaanites. So the one thing we should do, we should be careful when we are trying to give an interpretation. Because when you are giving interpretation here, then that interpretation would apply also to the Canaanite religions. So we have to be very selective and give the interpretation only if the Bible allows. So anyway, so why will you come here? This is the outer court, the 60 pillars I just said, and the four colors here. As you come here, this is the altar of sacrifice, and that is the wash basin or the laver. Now, until this time, there was no priesthood, and there was no particular place of worship, because everybody, like let's take for example Abraham, he went to the high place and he offered sacrifice. But when they came here, Moses says hereafter the sacrifices should not be offered outside. And then when you come to the book of Leviticus, there are five offerings which were given here. I'm saying offerings, I'm not saying sacrifice, because offerings are of two types, blood and non-blood. So the grain comes under non-blood, whereas you have many of those blood sacrifices that are given here. There are only five offerings, but there are seven chapters. Why do we have seven chapters? Because it differs according to economic status and also social status. For example, let's take the sin offering. He's asking to bring a sheep without defect. Not everyone can afford that. So you also can bring pigeons, or even if you cannot afford that, you can also bring the flour without yeast. That's how we know that Jesus Christ was a poor man, because of the offering that he bought. Also depends on the economic status, the social status. If it is a common man, it will be different. If it is a priest who did, it will be different. If the whole community sinned, it will be different. And if the community leader sinned, so that's why it's just five offerings, but it goes on into seven chapters in the book of Leviticus. Now, the prominent thing here, every sacrifice is different from the other. Now, for example, if you take the procedures, sometimes sprinkling to the sides of the altar, sometimes smearing the blood to the horns of the altar, and sometimes taking the blood inside, two or three occasions are there. So everything is different. One is different from the other. But one thing I want to say here, when we try to understand these sacrifices, the Jewish people mainly have an objection to what we are thinking, or what we are trying to think all these sacrifices are. So, for example, they will tell you, if you are saying the Lamb of God, it all represents the Lamb of God, why do you have bull? Why do you have goat? Why do you have pigeons? Why do you have flour even that doesn't even have blood? The second objection that they say, if you are referring to as the Son of God, you might have noted or not, the sacrifices for some of them could be either male or female. So if it is male or female, how does that refer to Son of God? So we may emotionally give our own interpretations. But the Jewish people, they say, this is a particular purpose why God has given to us, nothing to do with your Messiah. Now, my clarification on this point is, only the Passover festival, we have 100% representation of the blood of Jesus Christ. Because it was the same festival season, and there are five points that are important in the Passover festival. Male, without defect, blood should be shed, and bones should not be broken, and it should be a young one. So you see that the same thing during the time of the Passover festival, you see it in Jesus Christ. He is the Son of God, without defect, young, because he was 33 when he died, and his blood was shed, his bones were not broken. Bones were not broken because you see that the block that is there under the feet, you have the nail, that's the only archaeological evidence we have for the cross. We don't have, the cross could have been as you have it now, or the cross could have been a cross like that, or a T. That's why some people do calculations in the book of Numbers. We know that there were three tribes here, three tribes, and three tribes. And we know how many families there were in all of these things. Judah is a bigger one. So what happens if you take the tabernacle? Wherever Judah is, and if you put all the family, the number of families in line, wherever Judah is, you know, that line will be longer. And here, almost these three will be same, but this side will be longer. So it's a good observation where you are getting across, but there is absolutely no interpretation. Because the first thing is, we don't know how the cross was. We are assuming how the cross was, and we are trying to read into the text and try to find the cross in the way the people have been around that. You know, so we some of these things, they really don't matter. Now the horns of the altar, this is very important. If nobody is working with an axe these days, but in those days if they were to do that and it fell on somebody's head and he died, was it intentional or unintentional? Just by mistake. Okay, anything that is unintentional, they could come and catch hold of the horns of the altar. And then the high priest, he knows, he'll ask, why are you doing this? He will make his case, and then the priest will say, okay, nobody should do anything to him because it was unintentional. So many people who did things not intentionally, they came forward. We have no record in the Bible, but it has given physical salvation to many people who were involved in unintentional sins. But there are people who did intentionally and unintentionally. Both examples are given in the Bible. When Adonijah, during the time of King Solomon, he's a crook actually. He came, Solomon wanted to kill him, so he caught hold of the horns of the altar. But one thing he did, he also asked for forgiveness. So Solomon said, okay, I forgive you. I assume that you did it without your knowledge. But Joab, who was an army commander during the time of King Saul, he killed innocent people. So when he came to know that Solomon was trying to kill him, he caught hold of the horns of the altar. Solomon said, take him outside and kill him because he's not innocent. He's guilty. So it has really given physical salvation to many people who were involved in unintentional sins, not in intentional sins. Now, by the way, David, when he says, you are the horn of my salvation, in Telugu Bible, if you are reading, it says Srungam. Srungam actually means horn. I mean, the real horn, sing in Hindi. So he was running away from Saul when he was hiding in the wilderness of Judea. That time he was not anywhere close to this. So he says, Lord, you are my horn of salvation. Because if I was close to this, I would have gone and caught hold of the horns of the altar. That's what he's saying. Now, by the way, from Hyderabad to Warangal, if you go, you are done with Israel. So what happens here is, all those who cannot come and catch the hold of this, there are refuge cities. They can go into three on the east side of Jordan, three on the west side of Jordan. So they can go there and they can do the same. The high priest will give protection. That is the labor. Now, if there are two or three interesting things here, just observations. It is height is not mentioned. It has nothing to carry and go. And the women, they gave their bronze and glass. So this was a total contribution of women. So that's a noteworthy thing here. And it was for the high priest to wash his hands and legs before he went inside and after sacrifice. That's where he used to wash his hands. And by the way, to the time of the coronavirus, there was this verse that was spreading that says, it's in the Bible that we have to wash the hands and legs. That has nothing to do with coronavirus. It has to do with the priests washing his hands and legs before going inside. There is actually something to do with coronavirus. When there is some white patch, he should go to the high priest. He will quarantine him for 7 days. Then again you show, quarantine is there in the Bible. Nobody really talked about that. But these verses, you know, you pick up whatever you want. So they say, you know, we have to wash your hands. Nothing to do with communicable diseases anyway. So that's the level. Now, that is what is called the tabernacle proper. Why we are using the word tabernacle proper? Because the whole thing is called tabernacle. But in the real meaning, that is the tent because it has the cover. So technically, if you are reading any book in English, if you are coming up across the word tabernacle proper, that's what they are referring to. So that has four-layer covering, if you can see there. White and then black and then light brown, actually it should be red, and then the dark brown. So of course the description is given in the Bible. I'm not given it. This is the second curtain, as we can say. This is the first curtain, this is the second curtain, and then if you go inside these doors, we have created these doors. So if you go inside, we are entering into the holy place, and there is another curtain inside, as you know, that distinguishes between the most holy place and the holy place. So what we'll do is, we'll go inside, we'll remove our footwear outside, and as we enter inside, we'll be going into the holy place. But there is something that you need to observe outside. I'll just tell you what is that. Yeah, please, you go.
Thank you.
Somebody can show. There is a rod here running all the way up to the other end. There is a rod up there. So I will just tell the significance of these rods. So I'm not giving any measurements, because the measurements is, as you see, 1 cubit is equal to 1.5 foot as we know it today. But when compared to the Egyptian cubit, it's possible that it was more than 1.5 foot. In that sense, this might have been a little bit bigger, but not very big. It's almost the size that we have in the Bible. Now, how was this made? This is made with wooden planks. So you have 20 planks here, 20 planks here, and 6 planks there. But if you count the corner ones, it is 8. So total, how many planks do we have? 48 planks. And if you see each plank, under each plank, there are 2 columns here, as you can observe. And this wooden plank has 2 projections, two feet like thing that go fit into these columns. And we have these 20 planks, but it's just 1 silver base. But the calculation is for 20 planks, you have 48 columns there, so that you fix it inside. Now, the tabernacle was used just to fixing and dismantling. There was no use of nail or anything like that. But how do these planks, how do they stand? Now, the rods which I showed outside, you saw those, and I don't know if you saw the 2 rods. The Bible mentions about 5 rods. So, there are 2 up and 2 down. The 5th rod, usually you cannot see in a picture. The 5th rod goes through the planks. So, there are pictures which actually try to show you the 5th rod, then you should have the transactional, cross-sectional one. So, then you can see that there is a rod going through. But otherwise, to see, there will be only 4 in the picture. So, there are those 5 rods here, 5 rods here, and 5 rods there. So, this is the holy place, and that is the curtain which divides the holy place from the most holy place. Here, there are 3 objects, as we can see, the lampstand. And the altar of incense. By the way, if you are reading English Bible, there is no, unless you are reading easy to read translations, which I don't suggest, unless you are reading that, there are no different words for the altar outside and for this one here in English. But if you are reading Telugu Bible uses 2 different words, Balipeetamu idu Dhupavedika. In English, we don't have that privilege. So in the context, should tell you which altar you are talking about. And by the way, that altar also has horns. This altar also has horns. So when the high priest is coming inside and is smearing blood to the horns of the altar, we should make clear whether it is the altar of sacrifice or the altar of incense. For our understanding, not that there is an interpretation there. I will tell you one example. When a priest sins unintentionally, he comes here, brings the blood here, sprinkles on the curtain, and then he smears the blood to the horns of this altar. He takes the remaining blood, goes outside and pours it at the base of the altar of sacrifice. Now that you know the structure, you can actually follow where the priest is walking, what he is doing, in which place exactly he is. So, this is some of the things. No, so that's the golden altar that you have. But this is a lampstand. This is a golden lampstand, which has 7 branches. So, there are 7 lamps. 7 is a perfect number as we understand from the Bible. Other than that, I don't know if there is any meaning to that. But these are the almond flower shaped design. And then these are these round things that you have. Now, these lights, they're switched on in the evening and put off in the morning. The purpose of this is given in the Bible, to give light in this area. So the practical purpose, first we need to understand, is to give light here. Now, this was lit in the evening and put off in the morning. This practice should go on continually, it says. There is a link between this one and that one. When they light the lamps in the evening, they offer incense there in the evening. When they put off in the morning, they offer incense there. So there are twice incense are being offered on the altar of sacrifice. The trimming and the oil that is used, it's all very clearly described in the Bible. So you have the altar of incense here, the made with gold, and these rods to carry. This will be burning 24 hours. So also it says about the altar of sacrifice outside, the fire should not be put off. Now, if you read some translations, you will find a word or a juggle between words continuously and continually. Now, what is continuously? Without stop.
what is continually at regular intervals. So whenever it says, let's take this example, it says you should be lighting this it should be a lasting ordinance. Although it says lasting ordinance, we know that this is lit in the evening and put off in the morning. So continually, so in that sense, if you see, at any point of time, not that it should be continuously burning, but the practice of lighting this or the practice of offering sacrifices should never end. It should be going on. Unfortunately, there is no temple there, so they are forced to end their sacrifices now, but that should have been going on. So this is the temple of Shokhrit, and here there are six loaves of bread. This is the only interpretation, actually. If you go strictly according to Exodus, I'm not talking of the epistle to the Hebrews. If you go according to Exodus and the interpretation Exodus gives for whatever is here, this is one of the best interpretations that we have. The 12 loaves of bread are the 12 tribes. And then you have these things related to the offering and other things. This bread was changed once in a week, and only the high priestly family or the priestly family should eat this bread. When you are talking about Solomon's temple, by the way, there are a lot of differences between tabernacle and Solomon's temple. Not in the basic structure, I will tell you certain differences, because that is why we should not be over trying to get deeper meaning in the tabernacle, because what was in the tabernacle was not there in Solomon's temple, or additions were there in Solomon's temple. For example, the lampstand. In Solomon's temple, there were 10 lampstands and 10 table of showbread. So if you see a picture, the proportion will not help you to know whether it is tabernacle or Solomon's temple. But if it is Solomon's temple, you will have one lampstand, one table, this table, and another 5 pairs there, 5 pairs here. If you have something like that, it is not tabernacle, it is Solomon's temple. So an outside you can see there is this Boaz and Yakim too. It was 2 times bigger, 3 times taller, Solomon's temple. And you have the laver. It's not the laver that you see there. It was the sea on 12 oxen. And the 60 pillars that you have, they're actually 3-storied room facilities. So Solomon's temple was far bigger. Now, this is about the Levitical, the Levites, their dress. Beginning with the ephod here, and there are 2 stones here with Jacob's son's name written here in the order of birth. Then you have the breastplate. The breastplate, there are 12 stones representing the 12 tribes. We know that because the 12 tribes' names are mentioned on those stones. And then the belt, and then the blue color gown. And if he's walking, or whenever he's walking, the bells sound shrilling, because every day it cannot be of much significance. But on the day of atonement, when he goes inside, that is the only way. The bells ringing is the only way we know that he is alive. And the tradition says, not in the Bible, tradition says that they tied a rope and sent him so that if the bells ring for a long time, they would pull him out. But the tension is mentioned in the Bible. When John the Baptist's father Zechariah was inside, people were a little bit anxious. Why is he not coming out, or what happened to him? Probably the bells were not ringing. So, and then the inner garments, and then the turban and the beard. And this was what a priest should have. This is from where CSI or Lutheran or the Catholic Church, they get their dress code from here. Not necessary, or I don't want to say whether it's necessary or not necessary, but what we learn from here is this whole dress code was to give dignity and honor to the high priest. That's the main thing that this was there. This is the curtain, which is definitely not our door curtain. It was quite thick. It's not easy to tear from top to bottom or from bottom to top. Either way, it's a miracle, whether it's from top to bottom or bottom to top. There are cherubims here, 4 cherubims. There could be 6, some pictures may have 6 standing, only 2. So it's the plural in the Bible, so there is some sort of an imagination that people do have. So we are going with this, that there probably were, 4 or something. Not that there were 4, but we are just taking this. And one thing happens in Acts chapter 6 verse 7. It says many priests accepted Christ. The only reason we can give, it's not there in the Bible. When this was being torn from top to bottom, who do you think were inside? The priests. And how did the priests accept Jesus Christ? If this was a miracle, maybe the one who is dying on the cross at the same time, he also must be a miracle. If, as he claimed, he must be the Son of God, or he must be the Messiah. So it's very possible that the priests probably accepted Jesus Christ as the Messiah because of this thing which happened in the temple, the tearing of the curtain from top to bottom. If we want to give, interpretations to the tabernacle, I would usually suggest only one. The book of the Epistle to the Hebrews, where the interpretations about the tabernacle ends, that's in the book of Hebrews, better not to cross that interpretation limit. One of the best things that we have there, this curtain which is torn, according to the letter to the Hebrews, this curtain which is torn is the body of Jesus Christ which is torn for us. So when it tears, we can clearly understand what happened because of the death of Jesus Christ on the cross. But before that, this was torn at about 3:30 or so in the evening. Early in the morning, something else was torn. What was that? He tore it. He tore it. Caiaphas. When Jesus Christ was brought to Caiaphas, Caiaphas asked him, "Are you the Son of God?" He said, "As you said it." Then he tore his clothes. You know, what he tore was the dress that he was wearing. This is the high priestly dress. About this dress, there are rules in the book of Leviticus. Usually, in the Jewish culture, when the parents, the father, mother, they die, they tear their clothes. That's a symbolism of tearing, you know, the agony or pain or whatever. So, probably this guy, or not here, but this Caiaphas is the only one in the Levitical history who tore his clothes, which he should not have done. When he did that, it's not given in the Bible, when he did that, this priestly office comes to an end. Not only did his clothes tear, what also happened was, by evening, you have the curtain also which was torn. So, when the curtain is torn, from top to bottom, what can you say? Now that the curtain is torn, what can you say? There is no difference between the holy place and the most holy place. Therefore, with the death of Jesus Christ, there is no difference. We don't have an intermediary person called the priest. By the way, priest is a word used in the Catholic Church. I don't know if you know that. Pastor is a word that is used in the Protestant circles. Priest means a bridge, and pastor means the one who, it comes from the word pasture, the one who provides green grass. So this sort of an intermediary role is in the Catholic Church even today. That is what Martin Luther protested. But now we don't have any difference between the holy place and the most holy place. That is the Ark of the Covenant. In between the cherubims, the center place, the empty place, that is called the mercy seat. There is actually no seat there. There is no throne there. But the Jewish people called it the mercy seat. Now, it's good to ask this question. Why empty place was called the mercy seat? The empty place was called mercy seat because when this was made, God said he will talk to the Israelites from between the cherubims. And because God was talking from between the cherubims, they had this opinion in their mind. Their God was seated there, enthroned there, and from there he is talking. That's why when David says he wanted to bring the ark from Abinadab's house, he says, let us bring the ark where God is enthroned between the cherubims. So it's an imaginary place, the mercy seat. Now when we pray, we are saying, Lord, we are placing our requests at your throne of grace. That's what is there we are referring to. There is no throne there, but that is there. So with this, we have direct access to Jesus Christ. This is the blessing that we have now. And we should be happy about it. One thing about the Ark of the Covenant, before I close, people are searching for the Ark of the Covenant. Why are they searching? Because there is no temple in Israel now. If the Jewish people want to build their temple, they can replicate everything, but not the Ark of the Covenant. Why do they don't want to replicate the Ark of the Covenant? Because of Jeremiah 3:16. In Jeremiah 3:16 it says, you will not make this again. So the idea is, when they build the third temple, if and when they build the third temple, the Jewish people have this idea that it's the same ark which Moses made that should go into the temple. So that's why people are trying to search where the Ark of the Covenant is. If you go to YouTube and see where is the Ark of the Covenant, you have a number of documentaries. I don't really believe any of them. The Jewish people know where this should be. So this is it. And inside the Ark of the Covenant, you have the stone tablets, a measure of manna, and the Aaron's rod budded. In Solomon's temple, there was no Aaron's rod budded. There was no manna, only the stone tablets. In Solomon's temple, he had standing cherubims. One being touching the wall, the egg, and under these two wings, he kept the Ark of the Covenant. So there are quite a lot of changes.